Well, I'll try to bring you good news mostly. My talk is about the Intermarium. It is the lands between the Black and Baltic Seas. Speaking current terms, it's about our new NATO allies and associates in the East, hence from Estonia to Turkey. I will talk mostly about history, because history of this place is quite unknown. And this place is the reason why we fought World War I and World War II. That is where the greatest calamities of the 20th century broke out. If we don't pay attention to this part of the world, we may yet become embroiled in another conflict. And most conflicts can be prevented. True, sometimes you cannot negotiate with the orcas, as Howie's favorite politician Winston Churchill said, "Let's strangle the Bolshevik monster in its cradle." And then he said 10 years later, "Let's do the same to the Nazis." He was considered a warmonger and, well, intolerant, not open-minded. Sometimes that's what must be done. But most of the time, there are ways to manage, even prevent conflict. When I tell you about Intermarium, please remember that I will be suggesting ways to organize a space between the Black and Baltic Seas and the Adriatic sometimes too. The Poles call it ABC, Adriatic Bałtyckie Czarne Morze. So Adriatic, Black and Baltic Seas. Here's my map of Europe and Russia. Intermarium is an integral part of Europe. In fact, it's the heart of Europe. When you measure things precisely, the heart of Europe would be somewhere on the current Polish and Lithuanian border around Suwałki and Sejny, maybe a little bit overlapping on the other side. Conceptualize the space. It's very good for geopolitics. And here is a closer look of the Intermarium. Starts with Tallinn, ends with Constantinople or Istanbul and Athens. That's the Intermarium. Black Sea, Baltic Sea, the Adriatic. Some view this as a periphery. It would behoove us to start regarding it as a center of Europe. It makes things much easier than in terms of conceptualizing. If there is vacuum, and nature abhors vacuum, this becomes a funnel for invasions back and forth. If that geopolitical place is solid, prosperous, and strong, there's no funnel. There's stability. So from the point of view of American interest, we should support the space in between the seas and make sure it remains stable, because then there is peace. It's as simple as that. However, historically, the neighbors are not interested in stability. They're interested in weakness, and they would like the lands in between, the Intermarium, to be subjugated, weak, destabilized, and the only way that they see that this place ought to be organized is by the neighbors. Well, this place consists of people who have other ideas for themselves, so they would like to be able to enjoy prosperity and peace and stability on their own terms, not on the terms of the neighbors, whether, as you'll see historically, north, west, south, or east. They just would like to be left alone, if possible. That is a luxury and a nice wish, but remember what the Romans used to say, civis pacem para bellum. If you want peace, prepare for war. Here is Europe and Russia politically. Currently, we have a conglomerate, a collection of nation states. Some of them are part of a super state, which to an extent is emasculated, for it lacks a military and unified police force. It's called the European Union. What it doesn't lack is political correctness and libertine ideology, thus defying the original idea of free Europe with free markets for all. It is now a super state with regulations. How to climb a ladder, or what shape a banana can have to enter commercially the European Union. That's just insane. At the same time, it lacks in muscle, and it's confused about its identity. This contraption, artificial contraption, wouldn't endure if it weren't for the United States of America, aka NATO. Please remember that we have the European Union and the shenanigans of the welfare state because of the United States, namely compliments of the US taxpayer and the nuclear umbrella created by us. The Europeans can play their game and spend promiscuously on whatever social programs they desire. Well, the American people are a little bit sick and tired of it, hence neo-isolationism in its extreme form, that proposes that we withdraw from the alliance and from Europe. This would be bad news for world peace, primarily. The world needs Pax Americana, because in lieu of Pax Americana, there would be chaos. The Chinese, neither the Chinese nor the Russians nor anybody else, is in position to impose any kind of order. So those who dislike America's presence anywhere should consider this. No America, chaos. Chaos. It's as simple as that. Here's politically the intermarium. The western part, to more or less up to Croatia, is in NATO. And northern part too, and it is also usually in the European Union. The eastern and southeastern part, except for Greece, are ambiguous. Ukraine now would like to integrate with the West, with the EU and NATO. Belarus is straddling the fence. It doesn't wish to be absorbed by Russia, but at the same time, the government would like to maintain itself in power. And joining the EU or NATO or any Western structures is tantamount to a democratic election, which the last dictator of Europe does not wish to exercise or subject himself to. Do you know where the West is? I oftentimes ask my students. And do you know where the East is? During the Cold War, they thought it was pretty straightforward, because if you were under the Soviet yoke, you were the East. And if you were under the American protective umbrella, you were the West. Hence, Prague, or the Czechoslovakia at that point, was the East, and Vienna and Austria were the West. Did you know that Prague is further to the west than Vienna? And did you know that Helsinki, which is not on this map, but I'll try to recall it, Helsinki is all the way here. It's more or less where Tallinn is. So how come Helsinki were the west? To throw a monkey wrench into your geopolitical Cold War imagination, I'd say this. What's my favorite Western nation after the United States and Great Britain? Japan. We don't have the map of the world, but everybody would say Japan's the West. Really? Geez, it's as far east as it gets, as far as nation states. So how come during the Cold War we called it the West? Well, because it observed certain norms from which freedom obtains. Therefore, when we speak about the West, we mean freedom. So really, the topic of my presentation will be freedom in the intermarium. We'll talk about geopolitical space and about ideas, ideas of freedom. Most of you, or some of you at least, should know all of this. So please bear with me as I explain a complex situation, as you see, complex, to those of us who have not been introduced to the intermarium, to the lands between the Black and Baltic Seas. We have several schools and several tools of knowledge to rely on to reconstruct the earliest history of the intermarium. One is geography, which hasn't changed much since the last iceberg evacuated itself towards Norway and Sweden. So that's basically in their wake, they left the land shaped as follows. One of the most prominent features of the intermarium is the Carpathian Mountains. There are also more mountains here in a southwestern intermarium, which is the Balkans, and of course on the Greek peninsula. But the main chain is the Carpathians. The Carpathian Divide serves as a barrier. Invaders from the south try to avoid it. Unless they overcome it, and they hardly ever wanted to, from this side, they don't go up north because of the Carpathian Divide. So invasions, remember the Polish funnel, the invasions proceed between the west and the east and vice versa. The people who populate the intermarium have been there forever. What does it mean? About 10 years ago, archaeologists found a well-preserved body of a caveman in Wales. So they took DNA samples in a village close to the burial site. And it turned out the village history teacher was related to the caveman. That's what I mean. This is a very new branch, DNA. But it can be quite liberating. When I say new, it means it's a method. We need to work on it and we need to learn how to incorporate DNA information. I'll give you another anecdote aside from the history teacher. My very good friends, a co-worker at the State Department, was a black nationalist. She had a degree from Fletcher. She thought she was black power, purely African-American, very gung-ho about it. Then my friend, who's a DNA fanatic, asked her to take a DNA test. That black nationalist Marxist slash American diplomat returned like a deflated balloon to work. She found out she was 40% Japanese and nobody's talking at home. It's very liberating. You see, I haven't taken one, but almost everybody I know who has taken one discovers, you know, 2% Neanderthal. We are humanity, ladies and gentlemen. There was one common ancestor called the mitochondrial Eve. She was from Africa. And 95% of humanity shares the DNA. DNA, or preliminary studies based on DNA research, very preliminary research, suggests certain interesting things. For instance, there was an over-representation of people with Bulgarian DNA in what is now Poland sometime around 8th and 9th centuries. Do you know why? Because there had been a Turkic steppe people, Pecheneg, Bulgar invasion of Bulgaria. So some people fled north. It only makes sense. But then most of the time, from about the 12th century or so, 13th actually, there was an overrepresentation of people with DNA traits which are distinctly from white Rusinia or Belarus. Why? Mongol invasions. So obviously they moved west to escape the Mongols. Please don't look for purity. That's just a Nazi fantasy, so-called racial purity. We are all of us are common humanity. However, in what is the Polish lands now, most people, it seems from DNA, preliminary DNA research, have been there forever. They've absorbed various visitors. That's what DNA shows. Preliminary again. Now I'm mentioning it to you because it hasn't made it to history books. What has made to the history books is folklore, that is legends, linguistic studies, and archaeology. So let me tell you about the folklore. In the 16th and 17th century, Poland's nobility, which was huge, between 10 and 15% of the population, just to give you a reference to Western Europe, Germany's nobility constituted around 1% of the population. And that is the reason why our relatives, German relatives, are genetic freaks, because they married within one book for almost 1,000 years. No, sort of like the Egyptian elite, no fluctuation of fresh blood. In France, 2%. So in Poland, 10 to 15% of the population was noble, and because the elite was created during the time of the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, you could find anybody from Jews, Tatars, to Frenchmen and Italians in the Polish nobility. I'll talk about it a little bit more. At any rate, in the 15th and 16th century, and that entered folklore in the 15th and 16th centuries, the nobility and 17th thought of themselves as Sarmatians. Well, guess what? DNA studies show that indeed a bulk that migrated about 4,000, 5,000, 3,000 years ago came from all the way there, from the Iranian plateau where the Sarmatians really lived. How the heck did they know 3,000 or 4,000 years later to bring up the Sarmatian myth? It mystifies me. It must have been fairy tales told generation after generation. We are the Sarmatians. But there is a DNA connection. And as I said, no written record whatsoever, because before Christianity, those were largely in the Intermarium proliterate people. And Poland was so tucked away, that it just boggles the mind. How the heck would anything like this survive other than fairy tales? Repeated for thousands of years, which is, in my opinion, just very funny. Now, archaeology is not as rich as in some other places in Europe, yet it yields some interesting finds. For instance, there are Scythian sites, for instance, female warriors of the steppe in full armor, which casts another look at those ancient communities. There are naturally, down here, Grecian remnants, not only the wealth of Greece, which mostly can be found in the sea from ships that capsized or from various natural disasters. On the coast here, you can discover Roman remnants. Did you know Marcus Aurelius had his estates in what is now Croatia, on the coast? Ragusa, Dubrovnik, that's the same place. Here we find a variety of cultures, anything from Chinese to Arab coins. That means there was trade. Also war expeditions. Another important tidbit that you should know is that around the 9th century there was a war. It looks like it was a civil war, because almost all fortresses, grody, wooden fortresses, had been burned. So if you excavate, you see a new fortress, for instance, outside of Poznan, on the ashes of an old one. It means there was a war everywhere, and things had to be burned down. That suggests that the establishment of the what we call the Piast dynasty, right on the cusp of the Christian era, was a violent affair. Since they were preliterate people, we don't really know exactly what transpired. Moving on from archaeology, we should look at people and languages as evidence to understand what the Intermarium is. Most of these people here are Slavic people. The word Slav in English, German, and all other languages derives, means a slave, but it derives from an ancient Slavic word for the word slovo in Russian, Serb, Croat, and Slovak, and Polish slovo. Everyone between the Dnieper River and to the Elbe River spoke a language that had at one point shared a common ancestor. All these people could understand one another to a greater extent than contemporary Cataloons and Portuguese could. Everybody spoke the word, slovo, except in the outermost or westernmost marches, the Slavic people bumped into people who couldn't understand anything, and the Slavs couldn't understand them. These people here were referred to by the Slavs as the dumb ones, Niemi, those who do not speak the word. Why? Because the German sounded like so the Slavs assumed they had to be speech impaired. Hence Niemcy in contemporary Polish language, Niemi. They couldn't say anything. Imagine traveling between here in the Intermarium and there you could actually speak to anybody. And then suddenly in the West you bumped into people who were making sounds like Slavic speech impaired people. So they had to be deaf and dumb, or at least speech impaired. Niemi. Those people called themselves Teutons or Germans. As you see on the map, around the 8th century, the lands between the Oder and the Elbe River were populated by people who spoke the word, meaning some kind of a Slavic dialect. Here up in the north, where you have the Veleti and Oborites, they spoke a mixture of Pomeranian and Prusinian, as well as Slavic. So they were a little bit mixed. Now, what is left of these? Well, not much. The Sorbs, not the Serbs, Sorbs, dwell around a town called Chemnitz. There are 50,000 of them, and they speak something that, to me, when I read their language, is like Canterbury Tales for you. So archaic Polish. I understand them even less than I can understand, much less than the Kashubians, who speak early medieval Polish. The Sorbs speak a version from the 8th century. All those people were conquered by the Saxons from the Frankish Empire. And here's what happened. The Franks converted the Saxons with fire and sword. The Franks would baptize the Saxons and then slit their throats. So the Saxons would become Christian and go to heaven immediately, because the Franks didn't think that the Saxons were fit to survive. If you, and this is an important point, if you're converted to Christianity with fire and sword, then you tend to visit fire and sword on your neighbors, and that is what the Saxons did to the Sorbs, Veleti, and Oborites, who are pagan to boot, and Slavs. If you check the DNA of Eastern Germany, it's heavily Slavic, Western Slavic. As the tribes or clans or family groups spread during the great migrations of the people across the Intermarium, they developed various dialects. Hence, we distinguish now three main groups. Eastern Slavs, who call themselves Ruthenians, Western Slavs, and Southern Slavs. Southern Slavs are the easiest. Who knows how to say the South in Bulgarian or Serb? Yugoslavs. So they are South Slavs. And South Slavs now are divided into more or less Slovenes, Croats, Serbs, and Bosniaks. Their language is almost identical. They are the same people for the most part genetically, but history made them different. The Bosniaks, who had been heirs to the Bogomil heresy in the 12th century and 13th, converted to Islam during the Ottoman invasions. The Serbs stuck with Byzantine orthodoxy, and the Croats are Catholic because they once were a part of the Roman Empire. They are Latin Christians, yet they speak almost an identical language and hate each other. By the way, the Slovenes are also Catholic. Yes, it's usually very confusing, but just remember, South Slavs, West Slavs, and Eastern Slavs. Western Slavs used to encompass all these people here between the Elbe and the Oder River. Now they are German, because that fire and sword in the name of Christ. So Western Slavs nowadays are Poles, Slovaks, and Czechs, and the Sorbs, the little tiny pocket of Sorbs in Germany, 50,000. You can still go there. I think they now publish newspapers and do various stuff. At Versailles, the Sorbs asked to be absorbed into the Polish state, which was very shocking to many who had never heard about the Sorbs. They also tried to pull it off with Stalin, that is, they petitioned to become a part of Poland, since their region abuts the Oder River, and they thought they should be autonomous or a little slice of land jutting out from Poland to the west, but that didn't happen. They were absorbed into East Germany, the German Democratic Republic. And then you have the Eastern Slavs, who originally called themselves Rus, Ruthenians. They are now divided into three main groups: White Ruthenians, or Belarusians; Little Ruthenians, or Ukrainians; and Great Ruthenians, or Moscovites, or Russians. Three groups: Russians, Belarusians, and Ukrainians. Belarusians and Ukrainians are to the west, the Great Russians are to the east. By the way, label Great Russians denotes a geographic area. Just Great Ruthenia and Little Ruthenia, which the Moscovites translated into Velikaya Rus with imperial undertones, were simply geographic areas, no different than the region around Krakow, which in Polish is called Little Poland, Małopolska, and the region around Poznań, which is called Wielkopolska, or Great Poland. Now, I don't think anybody from Krakow thinks that the people from Poznań are Great Poles. Well, the people from Poznań think they are Great Poles, both geographically and metaphorically. In any event, the Slavic people by no means were the only people in the Intermarium. There were plenty of others. How many of you can speak or read Romanian? How many of you know Latin? Okay, one. How many of you know French? Okay, so you can read Romanian. If you can't speak it, you can read it. Why? Because the ancient Dacians were the easternmost province of the Roman Empire. So the language is based on it. Of course, the modern form of the Romanian language was invented as a hybrid in the 19th century during the era of nationalism, when the so-called Danubian principalities were clubbered together to create modern-day Romania. But the language is Latin-based. It's Latin-based. So you have people here who used to call themselves all here, more or less, who speak a language akin to Latin. Further, you have the Avars and the Magyars. During the barbarian eruption into Europe, a tribe arrived called the Avars. Remember Attila the Hun? Those are cousins, people who came with Attila. Avars and Magyars settled in the Pannonian plain. Those were the ancestors of contemporary Hungarians. They speak a language that is related to the Finnish and Estonian languages. However, unlike the Finns and the Estonians, the Hungarians can't understand their distant cousins. They are Altaic people. Hungarians, Finns and Estonians, they're Altaic people. They hearken from, the cradle of Korean civilization, basically, in the Altai. Far, far in Asia, by Mongolia. Now I got your attention. Now, don't ever tell a Hungarian nationalist that the tribe comes from the Altai. They will tell you, they have a myth like the Poles with the Sarmatians, that they are Turanian people who are related to Sargon of the Fertile Crescent and the great Turanian Empire in central somewhere, everywhere. In any event, myths are fantastic, and we could spend a separate lecture beating the drum of each of those national groups, because everybody thinks one is the greatest and the best and the most awesome. Aside from the Ungaro-Finnic language group, and aside from the Dacians or Romanians, you have a plethora of tiny minorities here. The map is too small, so I have to go back. But the most ancient people of Europe reside in two places, the Basques and the Albanians. They are the ancient Illyrian people. Have you heard of them? Yes, you have. Because most of you, at least the literate ones among you, use the term Pyrrhic victory. King Pyrrhus of Pontus was an Illyrian, meaning a proto-Albanian. They've been around forever. It's called, in their language, the country of eagles. It's very mountains, as you can imagine. There are also tiny little groups like the Vlachs, various mountaineer cultures. In other words, it's not just a blotch on the map. It's the people, and they are very heterodox, with ancient traditions and completely unknown in the West. Further, please remember that during the Volkswanderung, the great wandering of the people, which commenced in, the Altai, back in the Far East, and it was triggered by one tribe attacking another, despoiling it of its cattle and robbing it of its pasture land, hence prompting it to attack the neighbors to the west. This great chain reaction which took hundreds of years, materialized in Europe. And among these people here, there settled various waves of passerbys. Say, Goths. You can find Gothic remnants in terms of archaeology here and here. Why? Because they would stop for a couple of generations. So there would be a wooden fortress somewhere in what is now Poland or what is now Hungary of Goths, Germanic people. And then they would get bored and they decide to visit the Roman Empire, because who would like to live in a forest? That's what they did. So if you stay for 2-3 generations in one place and they say, oh, time to go, you leave behind you parts of your culture. Hence Adolf Hitler and his friends were going around Central and Eastern Europe looking for ancient Germanic civilization as proof that there was no culture but Gothic culture. And guess what? If you look hard, you can find spots here and there, which doesn't mean this was the only source of culture or even the dominant source of culture. Remember, these were vast territories to a large extent, not very populated. There were outposts of civilization, so a Gothic tribe could get lost. You know, there is also a story or a hypothesis of lost Roman legions. Namely, as the empire was collapsing, two legions went east and they disappeared from history. We don't know what happened to them. There are theories that they made it to Great Poland. Who knows? They were in search of survival. So they broke through the Germans and then they disappeared. And because we have absolutely no trace of a great slaughter, and that would have been preserved in songs and bragging, nobody knows what happened to them. They either dissipated or they settled somewhere and were lost. Yes, I've mentioned to you Croatia, but there are also Roman archaeological finds in Eastern Germany and Poland, and what is now contemporary Poland. You see, ancient people with hardly any written history. When you look at medieval history, you'll discover developments, delayed developments, akin to how things transpired in Western Europe, except under the Muslim occupation in Spain. Their history took the wrong turn following the Islamic conquest. But as far as France, what we call Germany, and even England, you can discover certain similar mechanisms of creating local dynasties. Some of these dynasties were foreign. What do I mean? I've mentioned Bulgaria and the Turkish people known as Bulgars. The only thing that's left of them is the name Bulgars and Bulgaria. They were completely absorbed, they conquered Slavic people, but they were completely absorbed by them. Completely absorbed. They lost their language, they lost their culture, it became Slavic for all purposes. In Rus, among the Eastern Slavs, among the Ruthenian people, the ruling class that emerged somewhere in the 8th and 9th centuries were the Vikings. The word Rus means rowers. The Vikings found a path, or so they thought, overland, usually sailing and rowing their boats down to the Byzantine Empire, which they raided from this part of the world. Most of us who were crippled by selective education as it's purveyed in the United States and elsewhere in the West. Only remember the Viking eruptions here. They sailed west, sacking a monastery off of the coast of Great Britain. They sailed to conquer Normandy. They sailed to set up their statelets in Spain. They also captured Sicily. Those are Viking states. Do you know the name of the Viking house which came to rule Sicily? Oh, you, all of you, especially the Poles, should know.
The Sforzas?
No, the Sforza were not from, that's northern Italy. No, just to put you out of your misery, d'Anjou. Oh, the Poles are still staring blankly at me. Jadwiga Andegaweńska, ladies and gentlemen. Hedwig d'Anjou was her name. The granddaughter of the King of Poland, Casimir the Great, and the daughter of Louis Lajos the Great of Hungary, or Louis the Hungarian. Yes. Do you know what the d'Anjou, the House of d'Anjou, was called in England? The Plantagenets, Richard Coeur de Lion. They were all related. In any event, my point is, in many places in Europe, including the Intermarium, and I'm giving you the example of Kievan Rus, the dynasties were foreign. Hence laws that are crude. For instance, in England, when William the Bastard, known as William the Conqueror, took over Roman, mostly Roman, or post-Roman England, the laws were dual for the elite and for the people. The Anglo-Saxons didn't share legislation with the Normans. The ruling class was afraid of the former elites and the people, so they set up separate legal spheres. Same in Ruthenia. In Ruthenia, the ruling class set up its own laws, and the people continue to adhere to Slavic customary laws. Certain things meshed, but the laws became remained differentiated. This is very important. Even once the Ruthenian elite, or the Vikings, became Slavicized. That's very important. Did you know that the last team of Swedish Vikings, Drużyna, came from Scandinavia to replace and to replenish the forces of the local rulers at the beginning of the 12th century, around 1120. So they kept in touch for about 300, 400 years, treating the place as a captured place. In European history, there was one prominent exception. Aside from Denmark, where native dynasty has been in power for over 1,000 years, there was one exception in medieval Europe, which had a native dynasty for a rather large state, which emerged, and that is, ladies and gentlemen, this, what came to be known as Poland. That means the laws were not dual. That means the monarchs were not afraid of the people, because they were the same. This doesn't mean there weren't any arrivals, foreigners settling and being absorbed, assimilating. No. On the contrary, there was always an influx of somebody, but the ruling elite was native. That means they were in congruence with the people. Even if they would absorb a few Vikings who came. There was a great hub here called Svanemunde, and the Slavs called it Świnoujście, a great Viking camp, which was part slave, part free, part trading outpost, part raiding base. And the Vikings were Slavic and Scandinavian. Viking means to go on an expedition, which can be trading or it can be rape. You pick and choose whatever worked for them. Very, very fascinating, ladies and gentlemen. Did you know that in the 10th century, the dukes of what became Polonia or Poland intermarried with the Danish dynasty, and Duke Mieszko, the first daughter, was the Danish queen. She brought 300 Polish warriors, which her son later took on the conquest of England. I'm referring to Canute the Great. Well, about 100 warriors came with a Viking friendly expedition and were absorbed into the Polish forces. Now, basing themselves solely on archaeology, a few historians have resurrected a 19th century hypothesis by Szajnocha that the Poles are Vikings too, because archaeologists have found a few helmets and swords that were Viking. No. The dynasty was native. The laws were in common. Unlike in most of Europe, the rulers were not afraid of the rules ruled because they were very similar, culturally speaking. It doesn't mean laws were equal. That's a long way before that. They were congruent. In medieval times, proto-nation states emerged for a variety of reasons. Those were remote places. The Roman Empire had fallen apart. The Frankish Empire was converted into a loose confederation known as the Holy Roman Empire of the German nation. The Byzantine Empire retreated. So those people set up medieval monarchies. Medieval monarchies which more or less correspond in their borders and people to what we have now as a collection of nation states. But most of those medieval monarchies disappeared for a variety of reasons. It started already in medieval times. The greatest threat and the greatest scourge of Christendom, for it was for the most part Latin Christendom, were the Mongols. The Mongols exterminated, ladies and gentlemen, almost everything there. Hitherto, the Ruthenian state was not like the rest of Europe, but it was very similar. So if a knight from Spain or Portugal arrived in the Ruthenian lands, he wouldn't find the coats of arms. Their customs were a little bit like the customs of Pechenegs and the Cumans, meaning the steppe people, yet he could recognize in them certain affinities and similarities because they were influenced by the Poles and the Hungarians, with whom they intermarried, especially at the dynastical level. But they also, the Ruthenians, intermarried with Western Europeans, and not only through the Viking connections, but through dynastical connections. For instance, Pedro the Cruel, a very cruel ruler of Iberia, of one of the Iberian kingdoms, married a Ruthenian princess. This was not seen unusual. I will talk now about one of the most important divisions, which I've already mentioned when I discussed the Croats, Serbs, Bosniaks, and Slovenes. Some in the intermarium, some became Latin Christians, Western Christians. Others became Byzantine Christians. The Vikings here, the Viking ruling class, brought Orthodox Christianity into Ruthenia. They embraced Orthodoxy. The Slavs, for the most part, Western Slavs, and some of the Southern Slavs, accepted Latin Christianity. This is very significant. Serbs, Bulgarians, and the Ruthenians looked to Byzantium for Christian instructions. The Poles, Bohemians, Moravians, and Slovaks, as well as Croats and Slovenes looked to Rome. They became Latin Christians. The most instructive, which bears on our story as we proceed into the future, is the tale of the conversion of the Poles. I've mentioned the Saxon penchant to emulate the Franks of bringing Christianity with fire and sword. Well, the Polish way was love. Namely, the Duke of Poland married a princess of Prague. Nobody died. The Poles just became converted. This is a method. The message of Christ is love. It is not fire and sword. And the Poles thought it was a good idea. They became Christian, which really upset the Saxons, because now the Saxons, the Germans, had no excuse to attack to the east. For the putative excuse was that they should spread Christianity. Once the Poles became Christian, there was no reason to continue, yet they continued, the Brandenburgs and the Saxons. I'll just give you one story. Who has been to Berlin? Who has been to the suburb of Berlin called Köpenick? Okay. Do you know the name of the suburb of Berlin, Köpenick, the original name? Well, archaeology proves that this was a fortress called Kopanica, and the name of the prince was Jaksas Kopanicy. He made one mistake. Namely, he invited German margraves Albrecht the Bear and Henry the Lion for a party. They brought their entourage, and when everybody got drunk, the Germans killed all the Slavs. From then on, the place was called Berlin. But the suburb's name was Kopanica. Yes, fire and sword, ladies and gentlemen, as opposed to love. And you'll see what I mean in about 10 minutes. Western Christianity spread. The Bishop of Prague, who had to flee his see because he opposed slavery. And slavery was widespread, hence the word Slav in Germanic and English languages, and French means slave. There were three main slavers in Europe at that time. The Khazars, the Vikings through the eastern and northern routes were selling people, and Iberian traders who were called Rashidites, they were Sephardic Jews. In conjunction with local elites, they were buying people up everywhere. So most of the local elites benefited from it. Hence the first written record of what became Poland from Ibrahim ibn Jakub, Abraham the son of Jacob, is from a slaver. He visited, bought slaves, and the mechanisms were just like in Africa. If you were a village troublemaker, I'd sell you. If you misbehaved, I'd sell you down the river. So the Bishop of Prague, his name was Adalbert, sometimes mistranslated as Albert. It's not the same name. Wojciech, or in Polish, Wojtek in Czech. The bishop objected, he was ejected, went to Poland, and began to proselytize among the Pomeranians. Some said that he annoyed the Pomeranians, which are yet another people, I will mention in a few minutes. He annoyed the Pomeranians because he transgressed on their sacred ground. The truth is, yes, that was the trigger which led to his martyrdom. However, he annoyed the Pomeranians because he said slavery was bad. And slavery was widespread. By the way, human beings are the most popular commodity since we have any written record either from China or the Fertile Crescent. That's just what people traded, other human beings. Slavery is nothing new, it's been around forever and ever. It's a curse in America because we were created here in America. It was assumed that all men were created equal. But in most places, what we dealt with was equal opportunity slavery. That is, anybody could be a slave. Anybody. Christianity spread. It introduced different norms. It introduced literacy. And the priests became administrators, state administrators, because they knew how to write and read. And they kept records. So we know more because of Christianity, for it ushered in a literate culture. There were several threats, but none of them was greater to this medieval getup. None of them was greater than the Mongols. The Mongol invasions completely depopulated Ruthenia all the way to the Pripet marshes, which are impassable until this very day. The Ruthenian principalities in the north, what is now called Belarus or White Ruthenia, sought an alliance and sometimes fought with or fought against the Baltic people called Lithuanians. One interjection. I've already mentioned the Finns and the Estonians. Sometimes the Estonians are lumped around Tallinn, are lumped with Latvians and Lithuanians as the Baltic people, where they are a separate Ungaro-Finnic group from the Altai. The Latvians and Lithuanians were the last ethnocultural group which entered Europe from the east during the Volkswanderung. And some of them overlapped with the Pomeranians, and some of them settled here, and they were known as the Prusinians. Please do not mistake them for the Prussians. Prusinians were related to the Lithuanians, contemporary Lithuanians. The heart of Lithuania was Samogitia, in Polish, Zmuj, and what is now Latvia, or the Letts, and Latvians. The second scourge was a crusading order which screwed up in the Holy Land, couldn't hack it against the Muslims, so it became unemployed and moved first to Hungary, from whence it was ejected by the king, for they meddled in Hungarian affairs instead of protecting Hungary from Pechenegs, Cumans and other steppe people, and the Mongols. So, at the invitation of a very silly Duke of Mazovia, Konrad, they settled in northern Mazovia around Dobrzeń. They were called the Cavaliers of Hospital of Saint Mary, and we know them as history as the Teutonic Knights. A subgroup of the Teutonic Knights called Sword-Bearing Cavaliers settled in what is now conjunction of Estonia and Latvia. And they brought with them that uniquely German way of converting the pagans with fire and sword, which the Poles didn't appreciate, because yes, the Lithuanians, Samogitians and Prusinians were really annoying, for they raided Poland for booty. Killed people, but usually stole people, that's what they like to do. For ransom. If you couldn't ransom, then they would have slaves out of Poland. That's why Konrad of Mazovia called the crusading Teutonic Knights to the rescue. Well, the crusading Teutonic Knights got to work, and by the 16th century, the last Prusinian was dead, and the province became Prussia. The name derives from Baltic people who were exterminated. Most of them were exterminated, others shifted to northeast and became absorbed into the Lithuanian group. The Teutonic Knights built a huge state which stretched more or less from the borders of medieval Poland to here. And they continued crusading. Now this was depopulated because the Ruthenians, especially the ancestors of contemporary Ukrainians, defended themselves to the last from the Mongols. This what is now Ukraine, was almost completely depopulated. The Mongols left nothing in their wake. It would not start recuperating until about the 14th century. So 150 years of desert. because the Mongols would return and destroyed whatever else was put in place. And the Teutonic Knights were putting anybody who was not a Christian to the sword. The Poles didn't appreciate it. The Lithuanians annoyed the Poles, more or less, because of the raids, because the Lithuanians were pagan. But the Poles didn't like the Teutonic Knights and their methods too much. They didn't think it was fun to kill people in the name of Christ. Therefore, the lords of Krakow approached the lords of Vilnius, the capital of the Grand Duchy of Lithuania, which mostly encompassed Ruthenian people, ancestors of contemporary Belarusians, and whoever fled to the north. They approached them and said, "Well, you should stop raiding us. We should unite against the Teutonic Knights who menace Poland. And also, you should embrace Christ with love, not with fire and sword." The Lithuanians agreed. So the Grand Duke of Lithuania married the King of Poland. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, this was history's first example of gender bending. Why? When King Casimir the Great passed away, he left no male heir that was legitimate, as he had a number of male issue, including with his favorite Jewish girlfriend Asterka, but illegitimate children did not qualify for the throne. So the lords of Poland embraced Hedwig d'Anjou, Jadwiga Andegaweńska, to become the king of Poland. What's the secret behind it? Hedwig was about 12 years old at the time. Poland didn't have Salic law. In the Slavdom, among the ancient Slavs in pre-Christian times, women could inherit, and they inherited equally. The Germanic tribes, which eventually coalesced to form the Frankish Empire and to pick up the mantle of the Roman Empire in Europe, adhered to Germanic ways, where women meant not much. They enshrined into law something called the Salic regulation. Salic law stated that women couldn't inherit, and most certainly they couldn't inherit the throne. When the successors to Charlemagne, Carolus Magnus, fought among themselves, there were a couple of women who were more qualified than their siblings, grandchildren of Charlemagne. However, according to the tribal Germanic law now enshrined as the Frankish law, women couldn't inherit, they couldn't qualify. The Poles thought it was idiotic. So, just to make sure nobody would think that the throne of Poland was vacant, when Hedwig d'Anjou, Jadwiga, little Jadwiga, was enthroned, in the coronation documents it stated she was the king of Poland. So now we had a gender-bending marriage of the King of Poland and the Grand Duke of Lithuania, a smelly barbarian in skins, that I'm quoting my grandmother, called Jogaila. Well, he came with his entourage, which included my family, the senior branch of my family, in 1389 to Krakow. And first thing that the Poles did was, where the heck do we sit those barbarians? I mean, the Ruthenian knights are at least Christian. They're schismatic, but they're Christian. But these guys are completely barbarian, the Lithuanians, Samogitians. They smell badly and they don't have coats of arms. Nor do the Ruthenian knights. And they all behave like the Mongols because they all kowtow before their prince. So what the heck is this? What do we do? So the Poles gave them coats of arms. Because then, that made the Lithuanians and the Ruthenians equal to the Poles. So everybody sat down and could have a big party to celebrate the marriage of the king and the duke. This was the beginning of a great story called the Jagiellonian state, and a great story which eventually culminated in the Polish-Ruthenian-Lithuanian Commonwealth, Europe's largest state, one that was created not by conquest, that was created eventually, as the preamble to the Union of Lublin says, of 1569, equal with equal, brother with brother, równi z równymi, bracia z braćmi. Completely unusual, because most European states were assembled by violence and conquest. And here, the principle, a Slavic principle of, hey, women are human beings too, that was news in Europe until the 20th century. One principle, and the second principle, love instead of violence. Europe's greatest state was assembled, which is also Europe's greatest mystery, because nobody knows about it. All we have is Polish jokes. Why? Because after about 400 or 500 years, the state failed. If something fails, it's a joke. The roots of Europe's freest early modern state descend to Slavic arrangements, tribal arrangements, including that there was for a long time no primogeniture, because it was considered unfair to other siblings, including women, that they couldn't inherit parts of their parents' estates. Not just the dowry, don't take me wrong, they stood to inherit, and that was the law. In medieval Poland, there developed at various princely courts and at the ducal and royal court a number of institutions which eventually coalesced to give birth to what we know as the golden freedom of Poland. The Intermarium's hugest state, as you see, encompassing much of everything. In the early 13th century, a few years after the Magna Carta, a duke enacted something called the Act of Cienia. The Act of Cienia stated that the duke should not do anything important without consulting his barons, lay and ecclesiastical, and the representatives of the burghers, as well as the nobility, ought to take part in this. Now, whereas the Magna Carta of 1215 was a joke, you know, as soon as John Lackland could withdraw his favors, he did, and nothing happened in England until the Glorious Revolution, really, the polls meant business. This was a cornerstone on which various freedoms were built. One of the most important was as follows. If we prefer love to violence, that means if my king wants me to go to war outside of the realm, I need a tax break. So otherwise, I'm not going. So the kings were forced to bestow rights, tax breaks, upon the nobility. And again, in the time of Teutonic or Lithuanian emergency, the dukes of Mazovia ennobled entire villages. That is without precedent. They're the only other places that were similar: Hungary, which explains Hungarian-Polish affinity, Hidalgos in Spain, who were free but poor, but well, they were free nobility, petty nobility, and Scottish clans, where you had dukes in one MacDonald clan and the poorest people in one, but they didn't have the rights like the Polish nobility to vote, to participate. And those rights in local assemblies eventually morphed into local dietines by the 15th century and 16th. The rights to taxations also morphed. But one of the most important laws enacted in Poland at that time came in 1436. It was called Neminem Captivabimus, ladies and gentlemen. That means nobody shall be held without a valid court verdict. Yes, 150 years before habeas corpus. That's why I said that the Magna Carta was a joke. 150 years before habeas corpus, the lands between the Black and Baltic Seas with a dominant hybrid personal union of Ruthenians, Lithuanians, and the Poles, and whoever else wanted to come, created a law where the king could not arrest anybody arbitrarily. 1436. Eventually, local dietines and councils, ducal councils, coalesced to create an electoral process, eventuating in the Sejm, or the parliament, national parliament, and the Senate. The lords were in the Senate, and the nobility were in the Sejm. About, by the 16th century, about 1 million free citizens participated. That the franchise would not be exceeded until Jacksonian democracy in the United States in the 1820s. The franchise would not be exceeded in Europe until reform acts of the 1830s in England. This is huge. We're talking 15th, 16th, 17th, 18th centuries. Poland was a pluribus unum before its time. The way the system worked was not only through elections to the parliament by the nobility, but also the cities have their self-governments and send representatives, non-voting, but consulting and lobbying to the national parliament. Further, several groups had autonomous bodies, parliaments. Who were they? Number one, the Scots had their own national parliament. They had autonomy. They were Presbyterian by religion, so they wanted to have their own thing. Scottish immigrants to Poland. Number two, Armenians had their own representative body elected. Number three, the Tatars. They were mostly Muslim who settled. They were oppositionists with Toktamish that who fled to the Grand Duchy of Lithuania in the 14th century. And last but not least, the Jewish community had their own Council of Four Lands. When you walk into the Knesset today in Israel, there is a picture on the wall of the Council of Four Lands. This was a proto-parliament of the Jewish people. And it functioned for about more or less 300 years. Almost until the destruction of the Commonwealth in the late 18th century. That's completely unknown, of course. That means the Jewish community could establish its own taxes, and it was self-ruled, like the Scots, Armenians, and the Tatars. More, according to laws of the land, the Jewish community was not to answer before municipal courts, because there was always a conflict of interest between the burghers and the Jews on the commercial field. So the Poles decided, when I say the Poles, I mean everybody. The word Polish was used generically to include barbarians like us, because I'm of Ruthenian origin, and the Lithuanians, and anybody who was nobility. That's what it meant to be Polish. Ethnic Poles, that term didn't really exist. If you were Polish, it means you were a citizen with rights, just like in the United States. Everybody here is of Irish origin or whatever else origin, but everybody says, hey, I'm an American. That's how it was in the old Commonwealth. If you said Polish, that meant you had rights. In any event, the Jewish community did not answer to municipal courts. When there was conflict within Jewish community, the Jews had their own courts. Same the Scots, same the Tatars, same the Armenians, and same everybody else. If there was conflict between a Jew and a burgher, Christian, the adjudicator was a royal starosta and a royal court because of conflict of interest. This is very important, and hardly anybody knows that. The Poles didn't stop at Neminem Captiva Bimus. The parliament in 1505 passed a new law, a new constitution, in fact. It was called Nihil Novi, nothing new without us, about us. Who can translate it into the American? Nihil novi. Nothing new about us without us.
No taxation without representation.
1505, ladies and gentlemen. Not 1776. 1505. And that's how it was. In 1573, upon hearing that Catholic fanatics massacred Protestants in Paris, the Parliament passed Confederation of Warsaw, granting religious freedom not just to Calvinist Lutherans, but all Protestant sects, and to make things even more interesting, to the Muslims and the Jews. That was law, that was the law of the land, 1573. Europe was ablaze with people killing each other in the name of Christ. My ancestor said, this is an abomination. No such thing. Jew, Muslim, Christian, all in one. This was the legacy of the Commonwealth. It is completely unknown. Unless you go to the Knesset, then they have that stuff. But in no other parliament is there even an acknowledgement that the vocabulary of early modern democracy was born in the Commonwealth. I've mentioned the concept of a poll and what constituted a poll. One of my most favorite entries in old documents that I enjoyed reading was as follows. A fellow introduced himself in a document. He said, Natio Polonus, Civitas Magnum Ducatus Lituanorum, Gens Rutenes Origine Judeorum. Do you know what that means? He said, I'm a Polish nobleman.
And the
citizen of the Grand Duchy of Lithuania, I am of the Ruthenian people and Jewish origin. That's how he introduced himself. In other words, he was saying, I'm a Pole. That's what he was saying. Oh yeah, there's a whole encyclopedia of Polish nobility of Jewish origin. In the Grand Duchy of Lithuania, if you converted, you were automatically ennobled. If you wanted to stay with your tradition, your people, and keep the religion, there were very few who were ennobled and retained their Jewish religion. This is completely unknown outside of small circles of historians. I don't know how snobbish you are, and that was beaten into my head. We were introduced to all of this. You look at your family and ancestors, you know, I have ancestors with last name Fabiani. They came with Bona Sforza, great Poles. Yeah, my great uncle Tadeusz Fabiani was shot in the Palmyre forest. Of ancestors who were Armenians, Jews, Tatars, and all of you, those who hearken from the old Commonwealth, have such ancestry, you just don't know about it. Why? Because the communists killed everything. First Hitler exterminated what he could, and then Stalin. So people lose their memory and they don't know where they are from. This way they become puppets and it's easy to rule them. Polish political thought. In the Renaissance, at the height of the Commonwealth's glory, was extremely well advanced. Andrzej Frycz-Modrzewski proposed that all inhabitants of the Commonwealth be granted the rights of the nobility. In other words, to enfranchise everybody. That was a great idea, except there was a problem. With limited means of transportation and communication, the franchise of 1 million people was already huge. Remember the previous experiments with republicanism, because the Poles thought they were emulating the Roman Republic, and democracy were limited to a city-state. So if you had about, in Athens, 30% of the population participating, and women didn't count as human beings, of course, in Athens, I'd rather be a Spartiate woman than an Athenian one who was ghettoized and sequestered and had no rights. Women didn't participate, so 30,000 in Athens, maybe 50,000 in Rome. This was huge! 1 million people participating. And please remember that It was not only nobility, for there were free farmers as opposed to feudal serfs, and there were royal farmers who are not feudal serfs. When I was writing my dissertation, I went to Poland to research for 2.5 years. I did a micro study, and among other things, having read 40,000 files in a local archive, I also walked around villages, and since my great uncle was a commando, I had to do fighting there in World War II. He was dropped from England into that area. All I had to do was show his picture, and then everybody would salute and be very nice to me, except the communists. At any event, because he was an equal opportunity hater, he killed communists and Nazis with equal glee. In any event, I would go from one village to the next and ask people, well, how come you were in the underground? And in Urzędów, they would say, well, what do you mean? We are the town of Marcin z Urzędowa, who in the Renaissance was a great thinker, blah, blah, blah. So they remembered. Then I would go to, say, Wilkołaz, and they'd say, what do you mean? This is where Ksiądz Ściegienny in the middle of the 19th century led us into battle against the Russians and the Tsar. Okay, so mentality from the 19th century. In Wierzchowiny, outside of Janów, the farmers would tell me, what do you mean? Pan Świda led us against the Bolsheviks in 1920. So that's what they remember. In Szydnik, they'd say, Panowie Poraj Wybranowscy led us in 1863. This is how the people would remember. I'd go to Wychów, they got offended that I even asked. They said, we've been nobility since the 12th century. Completely unrecognizable Wychów from the neighboring villages, but they were nobility, so they had corporate rights, they knew who they were. From the 12th century. Entire village of nobility, Hamlet. Then I went to not Modli Bożyce, but another village, Gościeradów, and I asked them how come they were in the underground, in the anti-Nazi and anti-communist underground later. And they said, what do you mean? We're Piechota Wybraniecka. We're the royal infantry. We've been fighting since the 16th century. All of this which I experience, stems from the Commonwealth and the collective memory. You can't say that the farmers were indoctrinated, because there were villages where people didn't know they were Polish. They thought they were just locals. And they thought foreigners were people from other villages. They didn't have a national mentality, but in the historical villages and neighborhoods, they did. And almost invariably, they would say either they stemmed from the Commonwealth, or they stemmed from the 19th century effort to defend the legacy of the Commonwealth. The legacy, this is in 1619. My family, by the way, is from here, the easternmost province of the Commonwealth, called Mstisław. How many of you have heard about the province of Mstisław? Of course, all of you have, because you must have read Sienkiewicz. Kompania Pana Kmicica, the companions of Sir Kmicic, all came from, except for Uchlik, who was from here, Courland. Well, they all came from Mstisław. By the way, Sienkiewicz used real names, which is very funny. I mean, if you're from there. But back when Sienkiewicz wrote, at the end of the 19th and early 20th century, the legacy was alive. Only communism robbed the people of the Intermarium from any memories, for the most part. Unless you come from a crazy family like mine, where almost everybody was unwell, and they kept those traditions alive. Everybody else was taught, or almost everybody else, not to remember anything, so the children wouldn't be endangered, first by the Nazis and the communists. The Poles practiced what they preached in terms of their domestic arrangements. Oh, I should mention one more thing. Liberum veto. Anybody could stand up in the Polish parliament and disagree with whatever legislation, which would terminate all parliamentary deliberations. This was a mechanism to protect the minorities, in particular, even a minority of one. And for about 250 years, nobody abused it. It was a parliamentary device where if John Niemczyk didn't like legislation that we all agreed on, hit se liberum veto, then we would abjure, form a caucus, and hammer out a compromise. For 250 years, nobody abused it. Then, I'll translate it into the American vernacular, foreign lobbies and great corporations bribed parliamentary deputies, and the parliament started collapsing. Anybody tried to introduce any reforms, a magnate, meaning great corporations, or a Russian ambassador or a Prussian ambassador would bribe deputies. That's by the end of the 17th century, and no legislation could pass. There was a permanent chronic parliamentary crisis because of democracy. Hence, some of the reformers proposed absolutist monarchy, and the Poles would have none. They said, there was a saying that the Commonwealth, Respublika, the Commonwealth, stands not by its government, but by the virtue of its citizens, which was translated into Polish anarchy. And that's not what was meant. But eventually, by the middle of the 18th century, that is what unfortunately ensued, because democracy and freedom tend to degenerate into libertinism and anarchy. I'm sorry, anything that's human becomes decrepit. Oh, the Poles also introduced the idea of a tri-division of power. How many of you have read the Optimo Senatore, the most illustrious senator, by Grzymała Goślicki, a 16th century treatise? No? Oh yes, you all. How many of you have read Hamlet by Shakespeare? Okay, so you have read the Optimo Senatore. Because Shakespeare, since the Optimo Senatore was banned in England by Elizabeth, who felt the tri-division of power threatened her rule, Shakespeare, who had read it, snuck it into his play called Hamlet. What was the name of the prime minister in Hamlet? Polonius. He was a bumbling guy, so the royal censorship wouldn't get upset, but he spoke in stanzas from the Optimo Senatore. He talked about reform along the Polish lines, even though he was prime minister of Denmark. So all of you have read the Optimo Senatore. Discourse like this permeated the Commonwealth. Before America, the Commonwealth of Poland was the beacon of hope, of freedom, long before America. It reflected on the way the Poles made their war. The Poles disliked offensive wars. For the first period of its domination, they kicked anyone's butt. Anybody tried to invade, he was defeated. The parliament hated levying taxes for defense. But the Poles had nuclear weapons of the age called the Husaria, or heavy winged cavalry. And they beat anybody who came for a very long time. The Poles also pioneered with their neighbors something called congressional diplomacy. It started in the 13th century. Instead of fighting, or instead of creating a global government, they had congresses of princes. So instead of going to war, they'd invite people to Krakow. And they'd get drunk, have chivalric jousts, and negotiate. Sort of proto-United Nations. Why? Because love is better than violence and hope and hatred. In 1414, at the Congress of Constance, the representative of Poland, Paulus Wladimiri, or Paweł Włodkowicz, the Bishop of Krakow, stood up before the Emperor and all royalty of Europe and said, we should not convert pagans with fire and sword, but with love, because that's what Christ wanted. You should have heard the collective thud where everyone's jaws dropped. Yes, imagine that. At the same time, anytime anybody moved in, the Poles were the first to fight. Polish king, 18-year-old Władysław, died at the Battle of Varna trying to stop the onslaught of the Ottoman Turks. Very many historians think that he was stupid, young, and reckless. Well, the truth is that he was outnumbered. He basically remained on the battlefield with his bodyguard. The Venetians betrayed the Crusaders, who were mostly Polish and Hungarian. The Poles covered the Hungarian retreat, and then the king, 18-year-old, figured that if he turned tail, he'd be killed with his retinue. So he decided to attack the Sultan himself, and an armored train of armored knights attacked the Sultan. They fell short for about 20 yards. He knew that if he killed the Sultan, the entire Turkish army would have disintegrated. By 20 yards, he missed. They were outnumbered 1 to 100. Not reckless, just, hey, before we die, let's make a splash. They had 2% of a chance in 100. It's very similar to what Dom Sebastian, I think in 1534, at the Battle of Alcazar Azir in Algeria, said to his Christian knights, the king of Portugal, looked at the Muslims approaching his tiny army, looked at his knights, and said to them, morir, die, but slowly. Same principle. Had they managed to kill the leader of the jihadists, that would have ended right there. Polish military leaders such as Hetman Jan Tarnowski, a great scourge of the Turks, wrote about just war, and they meant it, and also about humanitarian treatment of prisoners. This is completely unprecedented, 16th century. Once a country is prosperous and powerful, there comes a time to reflect on things that in our savage state we take for granted and don't care about. And that's how the Commonwealth was. It was the hugest, the most, one of the most wealthy and the most powerful in Europe. It was also unfortunate that it had such predatory neighbors, starting with Muscovy. The Muscovites modeled themselves on the Mongols. Not only did they believe in Caesaropapism, where the Pope and the Tsar, the Caesar, were one, but they also modeled themselves on the Mongols, where only one person mattered, the Great Khan. Nobody else had any freedom. And they used Mongol methods. The Poles withstood them. And by the Poles, I also mean Ruthenians and others. They withstood them for about 300 years. And then the Muscovite Empire expanded and absorbed Poland. Poland had to reckon with Sweden, too. Sweden, a powerful northern empire. The initial contact between the Swedes and the Poles was unfortunate because it was a dynastic quarrel. The Catholic branch of the Vasa family oppressed Protestants in Sweden. So it happened then that a Catholic king of or prince heir apparent to the Swedish throne was elected to the Polish throne, except in Poland it was a constitutional republic. So he didn't do any shenanigans against Protestants or anybody else. In Sweden, he could behave like a tyrant, and that triggered a Swedish rebellion and eventually Swedish wars. Those wars weakened the Commonwealth enormously. Eventually, Sweden was thwarted not by the Poles, but in the Commonwealth at the beginning of the 18th century, the Battle of Poltava, but it bled the Commonwealth horribly and weakened it through a series of wars which lasted over 100 years. Another problem was Prussia Brandenburg. A nephew of the Polish king was the last Grand Master of the Teutonic Order, and unfortunately the King of Poland and the Parliament permitted him to become a hereditary prince. So from stalwart papists, the Teutonic Knights became secularized, turned Lutheran, and established a principality called Prussia. The name of the ruling house was von Hohenzollern, the Protestants. And they eventually participated with Russia in the destruction of the Commonwealth. Last not least, but not least, was Austria, or really the Habsburg Empire. The Habsburgs competed with the Poles since late medieval times, especially with the Jagiellonian dynasty after the Battle of Mohacz, where a Polish king, one of the Jagiellons, died defending Europe from the Ottomans. The Habsburgs took over the southern front to a large extent, and they eventually built an empire that participated in the destruction and partitioning of the Commonwealth at the end of the 18th century. The 19th century was the continuation of the Commonwealth in the countryside, especially in the noble estates, and the modernization of the Commonwealth by the occupiers. So it was selective organization which fit the geopolitical and economic interests of the occupiers, that is Prussia, Russia, and Austria. Then came the short century, which most of you know, 1914 to 1989. World War I started in Sarajevo with the assassination of the Grand Duke, Franz Ferdinand. The Bosnian problems boiled over. That all was also connected to the retreat and dissolution of the Ottoman Empire, which became Turkey. World War I was bloody, but unlike in the West, it did not end in 1918. The Poles alone fought five wars, most importantly against the Bolsheviks. The only time the Red Army was vanquished in the field, it was in 1920. That bought freedom to everybody, for the Poles defeated the communists. And this is interwar Poland, the Republic. It was then destroyed by Hitler and Stalin. Make no mistake, World War II would have been impossible in the shape and form had not the communists and the Nazis made a common cause, because Hitler vowed never to fight a two-front war. He would have not attacked in September 1939, because he had no guarantee and he feared that the West would act. He figured the Poles were crazy, and since the Poles refused his wooing and he had been tickling the Poles to join the Third Reich against the Soviet Union for years, and the Poles said, by the way, no. Stalin approached the Poles to partition the Baltic states together, and the Poles said, by the way, no. But Hitler figured that the French would not move their butts to help Poland, and the Poles were crazy and they would attack Germany should Germany launch a war against France. So that was it. The result of opposing both the Nazis and the communists, both Hitler and Stalin, was the destruction of Poland and the domination of the Intermarium by the communists and the Nazis. Later, what ensued was Hitler's war and Stalin's victory, domination of Central and Eastern Europe for the next 50 years by the Soviet Union with local native communist stooges. The post-war didn't end in liberation. It ended in transformation in 1989 to 1992. Ladies and gentlemen, communism, transformation, not democracy, not freedom, post-communism. If you destroy this, then you would have freedom. Instead, the monster changed its shape, and the phenomenon is known as post-communism. That means the communists retained all economic influence. Communists and their collaborators retained all economic and political influence. Hence, you see a string of rebellions, including Maidan now, Moldova is aflame. And it will never end until this is solved. The legacy of post-communism will haunt us. You see, now that I've introduced that which is unknown, everything else will make sense. Look, this is NATO. All those countries were able to join NATO. They're NATO members. None, except by imaginative bookkeeping, none spends enough for defense. The United States carries everything. That's the truth. The Poles have now and the Bulgarians began to spend a little bit more for defense. The Balts can't measure up to anything. And here's how Muscovy, Russia, post-Soviet entity views the world. They feel surrounded. This is what they see. This is the view from Moscow. Completely not like we do. They feel surrounded and they feel threatened. And this is Europe according to Vladimir Putin. Take a moment to read this. By the way, this is based on the primitive distilling of Russian propaganda. This is what they would say about those countries. Kremlin spokesmen say this openly. So it was distilled into one map. It's funny, but it is tragic. Here's demographics. Total fertility rates. Spain and Poland and Moldova are well beyond replenishment. Where you have France and Ireland, etc., it's usually Muslim immigrants multiplying. Abortion rates, except for Portugal and Poland, the hugest, up to 87.5%. is the post-Soviet zone, Russia. This is their primary method of birth control. Number of people over 65. The most hard-pressed is Germany and Italy. The Poles are okay. The economic freedom index, Switzerland is the best. Georgia is like Czech Republic, Germany, and the United Kingdom. Poland is all right, over 60%. And then everything else declines. Belarus and Ukraine suck. GDP per capita. In the intermarium, well, it's pretty bad. That's why there's no data. The most prosperous ones are obviously Western European and Northern European nations. The old Soviet bloc countries are not doing so well, but Slovakia and the Czech Republic are okay. They're on par with Greece. Greece is a basket case. It basically exists on German handouts. Wages. Switzerland is not in the EU, but it has the highest. The US has $15,480 per capita. Ukraine has $3,876. I think Greece has about $6,000, so it's better than Poland at $4,500. Scandinavia, it's pretty high, $18,632. Norway even better because of its oil. Denmark is pretty good too. Here you have religions in Europe. Who is religious and who is not religious? Roman Catholicism, Protestantism nominally, Orthodox Christianity and Islam. There should be huge blotches of Islam in all major towns. In Scandinavia, Germany, France, Italy, weekly religious attendance. Ireland, Poland, Italy and Slovakia lead. Belief in God. Romania is even better than Poland. It's like Turkey. Portugal and Poland are the same. Everybody else more or less is tepid. And here's the last part of my presentation, the current crisis at hand. Migrants. According to the media, they mostly come from Syria. It's not true. That is the path until Hungary blocked it. And the migrants have found alternative routes. I'll show you. By the way, there is a collusion between the Turks and the Greeks. The Greek government said, pardon my French, screw the Germans, let them pay for everything. We're letting everybody through. To bypass Hungary, they go through Croatia. The Croats and Slovenes have been building a wall. These are the sources of current immigrant crisis. There are two hubs. One is Turkey, the other one is Libya. Of course, most refugees from the Syrian war are internal. Around 10 million people have been displaced. Half the population of Lebanon now is from Syria. There, at least, they go to see their families and cousins. You have 2 million people in Turkey. 500,000 at least in Jordan. Israel takes nobody, period. One of the most overlooked and important tracks is through Libya. Libya is in a state of collapse, so the borders are porous. People march from Somalia, Eritrea, Sudan, and reach Libya, then hop on a ship and make it to Italy. But the most important hub is Turkey, from then to Greece and elsewhere. And here's this is not the Ostrogoths, this is the Visigoths. And the Visigoths conquered Northern Africa, Iberia, and everything else, because there was no one to stop them. The Romans had no idea what the heck was going on. This time, you don't even have to burn anything, unless you want to. And here's the plan to relocate within the EU. We just had a speech at my school, the Institute of World Politics, by my former student who's with, let's just say, with the Germans. He's an ally. So the Germans expect 3 million. Not 500,000, 3 million. And I'm talking about intelligence, law enforcement, and military. So he was speaking not for German politicians. He was speaking for the people who actually will have to handle the influx on the intelligence and military and law enforcement side. 3 million, not 500,000. So the numbers here are disingenuous, given to the media to calm the population down. And here's the human wave. This is a picture from Hungary. See Hungarian officers in hats up in front. Remember, EU law says that you have to register at the first place you arrive. The Greeks ignore this. So the wave marches on. The Schengen, to an extent, is dead. The Germans have deployed border police to the Austrian border. This is not a joke. Doesn't make the media. Same the Austrians. So informally, Schengen treaty has been overridden. So nobody likes to say anything openly because then you're intolerant. But the truth is, it's a huge crisis. There have been riots in one of the, or a couple of camps in Germany, because the most of the migrants are young men, so they demanded sex. The Germans were very shocked. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I didn't just prepare it for you. I have that stuff from earlier. I'm the only person in my school that doesn't have a security clearance. That's why I can meet you and talk to you openly, and I can tell you anything my little heart desires. Of course, I'm making everything up, but here you go. This is the same dude. Look at the face here. That's how we recognize him. He's now a peaceful migrant from ISIS, the Islamic State. Here's another one. And this is just what I can show you. Now, it's true that migrants usually come with young men heading the exodus. They set themselves up and invite their families. But some of those people who are now in the EU didn't come to invite their families. They came to blow themselves up. The Mossad told French intelligence 4 days before the recent Paris massacre, 4 days before. And the intelligence community in France informed the civilian authorities, but the civilians were too tolerant and open-minded to do anything about it. The Iraqi intelligence told the same thing without knowing that the Mossad had informed already. Same thing a day before the attack. Nothing. Zero. Because you cannot, if you're a liberal politician, do anything to protect your own people, lest you'd be construed as a racist. This is not a question of racism. It's a question of national security. It's simple as that. This is Hungary's border fence. And here's Polish soccer fans. Każdy Arab niech pamięta, dla nas Polska to rzecz święta. Every Arab, let him remember that Poland is a sacred thing to us. No ISIS. And here's the crescent crossed over. There is no political correctness among those people there. Without American leadership, this whole project is going to collapse. Without American leadership, there will be chaos. And unless these people start organizing themselves in blocs, the Intermarium, under American leadership, they will not be able to withstand the onslaught and the current challenge, which is what the heck to do with this huge mess that the Middle East is. Thank you very much. Now, you have to forgive me for talking about history 1,000 years ago, because I'm a historian and I see how everything's connected. If you got a political scientist, he'd only talk about the last 15 minutes. And it doesn't explain anything. We all are from somewhere, our roots are something or other, and we are the way we are because of what our ancestors did or didn't do. And now we're entering another crisis stage. America's leading from behind. It means it's mostly absent. It's a very dangerous situation. Someone dropped the ball. I didn't vote for him. It's all Howie's fault. And we will all pay the price. We will pay the price for politicians trying to be popular. Can't blame them. That's the nature of democracy. But at the same token, we can only wish that other countries would have intelligence services as formidable as the French. The French have been working with us forever. Not Quai d'Orsay, not the foreign ministry, but French intelligence and French military are very good allies. Not to be confused with the French government. They're a separate entity. The political culture in France is not like with us. It's not like in the United States. So the French intel and French military and law enforcement are formidable. Not the French civilian part of the government. It is just the EU. Remember, at the inception of the EU, the question was before the Mont Pelerin Society, which means monarchists and libertarians, and the étatistes of Jean Monnet and Robert Schuman. And the EU picked the French étatiste model. So we'll see more problems.